The next principle we're going to talk about is Liskov's substitution principle. So what does this say? Let's say you have one parent, right? And child 1, child 2 and child 3. Any of the children, any and every children should be able to substitute the parent, right, in while providing the functionality. Like, for example, if I say I create a list of parent objects, list of type parent, right? Let's say M list. And let's say new list of type P. Right? Now if I say there's a function called as fire in parent class, all of these child classes should be able to provide this fire functionality without any kind of exception or error, or even exception or error are not allowed, and apart from that, that functionality should be meaningful. It's not like these two child classes provide the fire functionality and third child class just prints the statement, I can provide fire. Basically, it's not providing any functionality, it's just printing a statement, right? So, technically, it's not violating Liskov's substitution principle, but is it actually providing meaningful functionality for fire? No. So, let's take an example. So, there was this Don. He's a legend in that drug business. Now, he has three sons. And what happens one day is that this Don gets killed by a rival gang, right? And now they have to elect the new head of this mafia or this drug family, right? Mafia family. So they elect the eldest son. There are three sons, but they obviously elect the eldest son. As it turns out, after some days, that this eldest son was actually the son of the Don's neighbor. Yeah, exactly. You got it. So he's the son of his neighbor, right? And his neighbor was a famous cook, right? So now this, our elder son, who is now the new boss of the family, when he's asked to do business with rival members, when he's asked to do negotiations, or at times he's supposed to kill the other rivals, he offers them tea. He makes them sandwiches for breakfast. Everybody is so shocked by this. But yeah, you know the reason. We know the reason, right? So basically, in that case, that is violation of Liskov's substitution principle. In the sense that the child is not being able to substitute his parent for providing the functionality promised by parent. So let's now talk about the next principle, that is I, interface segregation principle. So what does this principle say? It says that any client should not be forced to implement any interface which is irrelevant to it. For example, sometimes you go to a place to eat and you find this place as Rocky Bar and Restaurant or Jamila Bar and Restaurant, right? And then you go to this place and you sit down and this waiter comes after some time and he leaves you with one menu. You open it and it's a bar menu. So it has this, you know, tequila, beer, vodka and all those things. I've seen at times this happen to my parents, that they're absolutely clueless. What are they supposed to order now from that menu? And sometimes they even thought that there's nothing else in this restaurant. That's all they're going to get. And even they ended up ordering something chakna from that menu, whatever was left. Yeah, but the point is, to have some separate menus and do not provide the menu of bar to the people who are only for the purpose of eating, right? Do not provide the people who are only for the purpose of drinking with the restaurant menu perhaps, right? So that is what interface segregation principle is. Do not force any client to implement an interface which is irrelevant to it. So the technical example of this would be, I have a booking class,
right? For sure I'm going to do booking, right?
In this booking class, I'll have some methods, such as let's say two methods, booking details and payment details. So let's say this requires a member, and this requires now payment details. Right now we have in our facility we have only cash payment, right? So what we did was that we decided to have one iPayment interface. Right? This iPayment interface will have one method called as save payment details. Right? Save payment details will save payment details such as what is the name of the person who paid, address, contact number, and something like that. Usual payment stuff. So we have a database. Let's say we have a database of payment details here. So the stuff like name, address, right? Let's say member ID, name, address, amount. We'll implement this method save payment details. In that, what it will do is basically it will store the member ID, name, address, something like that, right? Now, as we expected, after some time, the administration realized that we must introduce card payment. So we'll introduce card payment at the counter as well as online card payment. With the card payment, be it counter card payment or online card payment, we needed to have some more information about the payment, such as card number, right? Card type, like Visa or MasterCard. Again, debit card or credit card, right? Bank name, something like that. This additional fields we added to our database. So now, because we had this additional fields, right? Because we want to introduce card and online card payment. What we did, one way we could do that is that we could say iPayment has one more method, save card details, right? And now this method will be obviously implemented to store these additional fields like card number, card type, and bank name. So now we have one more class, let's say card payment. Card payment also implements iPayment, right? And it also provides the behavior for both these methods, save payment details and save card details. So here it stores the name, address, amount, and in the save card details, it will save the card number, card type, bank name, etc. Right? We can have one more class called as online card payment, right? Which also implements iPayment. Again, it provides the two methods, because it has to provide the implementation to save payment details, save card details. Now, the problem with this arrangement is that now your cash payment class, because it is implementing iPayment and you decided to add one more save card details method, it will have to provide implementation for save card details. Although in cash payment, you don't have any card details. There's nothing to save for card details because you're making a cash payment. But because you altered your iPayment interface and added one more implementation there, it has to provide implementation, right? So this is breaking the interface segregation principle, because now you are forcing cash payment class to implement iPayment, which is not totally relevant to it. Card details are not relevant to cash payment, right? So what is the solution? So what we shall do is that we shall remove this method from the definition of this interface, right? And we shall create another interface called as iCardPayment. And in this interface, we shall have a method saveCardDetails, correct? Now, cash payment will only implement save payment details, right? Cash payment will only implement save payment details, where it will say amount, name, address, right? Things like that. Whereas for your card payment and online card payment, you will definitely need to save payment details such as name, address, member ID, amount. In addition to that, you need to save the card details. So your card payment class can implement iPayment as well as iCard payment. So now your card payment class is implementing both the interfaces, iPayment as well as iCard payment. And what it can do is that it can first provide implementation for save card details, card number, card type, bank name, and then it can provide implementation for save payment details, where it will save the amount, address, name, right, member ID, and then we can actually call this save card details method here, right? So that in this case, what will happen is that for card payment, we will be able to store these details, amount, address, name, and member ID. And in addition to that, we will be able to store card number, card type, and bank details also. Right? Similarly, we can have here. So even online card payment class will implement two interfaces, both iPayment as well as iCard payment. So even in this case, online card payment will be able to save the normal payment details such as name, address, amount. We will be able to save card number, card type, and bank name, right? So now cash payment doesn't have to implement iCard payment because it does not need to. So we are following the interface segregation principle. Okay, so we now come to the last principle, that is dependency inversion principle. So my booking class is always going to need an instance of iPayment, right? So in this case, solid principle says that the responsibility of creation of dependent object should be outsourced to the consuming class. That means because my booking will need an instance of payment, iPayment, whichever class, wherever I am going to create instance of booking, let's say booking B equal to new booking, wherever I am going to create an instance of booking, that consuming class has the responsibility to provide the instance of iPayment. It is not the responsibility of booking class to decide how to create iPayment B instance. So I remember this example from my real life is that one of my supervisors always used to say the best way of management is to outsource the responsibility to your team members. That is, let's say you are the manager and you have 5 people in your team and they have been assigned the task, different tasks, right? So these people should set deadlines for themselves. He always used to say to us, you are supposed to do this task. Now analyze it, set the deadlines, and come back to me with the deadlines, and then I'll plan accordingly. So if payment type equal to cash, right? Say P equal to new cash payment, we can create object, and then say P dot save payment details, right? Or let's say else, you can say P equal to new card payment and then say P dot save payment details. So here what you are doing is that you are also having the logic of deciding which instance of, how will you create instance of iPayment? iPayment will be implemented by which class? Cash payment, card payment, or online card payment? In your booking class, You are deciding this, you are writing this logic of deciding how to create object of P, I payment in your booking class. Is it really relevant? No. So that's what dependency inversion principle says. Dependency inversion principle says that the responsibility of creating a dependent object should be outsourced to the consuming class. You don't need to write this logic here. It's not a responsibility of booking class.
So I'll write a constructor. Let's say booking, which I'm going to take I payment membership, right? Member M and I payment payment, let's suppose. And in the constructor, I'll initialize my instance variables. So I'll say P, this dot P, whatever, equal to payment, and this dot M equal to M. That is right. So I'm initializing these variables in constructors, and then save payment details. I'll simply say P dot save payment details.
Now I have removed that entire logic of if this create this, if this then create this. Instead, wherever I'm going to instantiate booking, in whichever class which needs to do booking, we'll say if the member is having card payment, I'll say booking B equal to new booking some member comma new card payment. Automatically this will be instantiated for P, which will be saved as P, which will be assigned to instance variable P, and accordingly method will be invoked. Card payment right here. If the member is trying to make or willing to make cash payment, then I'll instantiate booking as new booking. Are you getting it? If the member has decided to do booking online and use online card payment, then I can say payment. Right? So, but this code has to be in the class at some place, at some class, which is consuming your booking class. This logic, that if-else logic, should not be present inside the booking class, because it is not booking class responsibility to decide I payment which will be implemented by which type. Right? So that is dependency inversion principle. So with that, we have finished all the principles, solid principles for designing object-oriented systems. So in the next video of this series, we will learn how to draw class diagrams. So we discuss these techniques, these guidelines, right, conceptually and also technically. But designers need some notation, designers need some diagram to quantify that, right? So in the next video, we will learn how to draw class diagram. And the video after that, we'll actually learn how to model problem statements. So see you there in the next video.